Good morning, church. It is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. We are starting a new series today. We finished our series on the art of neighboring, and it is now the season of Lent. We celebrated Ash Wednesday this past Wednesday night, and we're going to spend these next 6 weeks leading up to Good Friday and Easter. And for these next 6 weeks, we're going to be looking at a section of chapters in the book of John where we get a really detailed, granular look at the last 24 hours of Jesus' life. And we're going to begin that today. Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 41. And I want you to listen to these words carefully because we're going to refer back to this during our scripture reading today. I'm going to read verses 4 through 10 of Psalm 41. As for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me. Heal me, for I have sinned against you. My enemies wonder in malice when I will die and my name perish. And when they come to see me, they utter empty words while their hearts gather mischief. When they go out, they tell it abroad. All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. They think that a deadly thing is fastened on me, that I will not rise again from where I lie. Even my bosom friend, in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted the heel against me. But you, O Lord, are gracious to me, and raise me up, that I may repay them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We are going to worship the Lord together in song, and we're going to begin this morning by singing, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus. It's hymn number 24, if you want to follow along in your hymnal, and you may stand.
Jesus, vast, unmeasured.
Facebook today, welcome. We're glad you're here. Leave us a comment. Let us know that you're worshiping with us, and we're going to take a few minutes to greet those around us in the name of Christ. That's right. You know, the communications professor. We've been talking about loving your neighbor, and now we're practicing it. I'm going to invite the kids to come forward. It's that time for the children's message. So kids and anyone young at heart, feel free to come on down. Good morning. How are you guys doing today? Good. We had a holiday this week. What holiday did we celebrate this week? Valentine's Day. So I brought this with me. What is this? It's a heart. What does a heart signify in our culture? Love, right? Love is an interesting word. I'm going to pass this around. I'm going to ask you to tell me one thing that you love. Ready? She loves her family, she said. We all love our family. I was going to say my daughter. I love my daughter. So family is top on the list today. We all love our families. And love is an interesting word, right? Because we love our families. We love our moms and our dads, and if we're older and we have kids, we love our kids, and we even love our dogs and our cats, and we love chocolate, and we love pizza, right? So we're kind of straying off into some different territory, aren't we? So what's the difference between loving your mom and loving chocolate? Did somebody say no difference at all? Got any thoughts? Okay, you truly love your parents. That's good. Would you do anything for chocolate? No, there's limits to what you would do for chocolate. How about your mom? Would you do anything for your mom? That might be the difference, huh? That when we really, really, really love something or someone, something that's really, really important to us, we'd do just about anything, right? I feel that way about my daughter. I would do just about anything for my daughter. In fact, I can't think of anything I wouldn't do for my daughter, right? Because she's so important to me, just like your families are to you. They're so important to us, we'd do just about anything. And our scripture story today, we're going to read about Jesus showing his love for his disciples in a really interesting way. And I'm sure you've heard the story before. It's right before the Passover feast, and Jesus is in a room with just his 12 disciples, and he takes off his robe and he wraps a towel around his waist, and he gets down on his knees, and do you know what he does? Remember the story? No, he washes their feet. Do you remember that story where Jesus washed his disciples' feet? Right? He gets down, and this was something back in their time that was, you know, for us, we think that's kind of weird, right? Washing somebody else's feet. Feet are kind of gross, right? But back in that day, they walked everywhere. They wore sandals. It was dusty, dirty roads. So their feet would often get very dirty. And typically, when you went into somebody's house, there was a servant or somebody in the house that had a bowl of water by the door, and they would wash your feet when they came in. But it was considered something that only the lowest servant would do. And so Jesus was showing his disciples that even though he was their teacher, that he was willing to get down on his knees and wash their feet. And at the end of that story, he said, "Now that you've seen what I did, go and do likewise." So he was giving us an example of what it looks like to love people, to be willing to serve and to do things that you would normally not want to do. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for our families. We thank you for our pets. We thank you for chocolate and pizza. There's all kinds of things that you've given us that we love. And God, teach us how to love better. Teach us to continually learn what it means to love others, what it means to serve and sacrifice and just care for the people that you've put in our circle. God, we love you and we thank you that you continue to love us in spite of ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can go to Children's Church. And we are going to take a moment to talk about confession and words of assurance. And as we think about that story today, this story of Jesus washing his disciples' feet, it's an odd story, isn't it? That Jesus, who they knew that he was their teacher, they called him teacher and they called him rabbi. We, of course, have read the story multiple times, and we know from the story that not only was he teacher, not only was he rabbi, but he was God in the flesh. He tried to tell them that, but it took him a while to figure it out. But he was God in the flesh, and he was willing to take off his clothes, to wrap a towel around his waist, to get down on the floor and wash his disciples' feet. And in our time of confession this morning, I want us to think about humility. We are a prideful people. And I say we because I count myself in that number. I'm a prideful person. Right? We read last week in our scripture from Paul, he said, don't think of yourselves more highly than you ought. Because he knew that we would get caught up in pride, caught up in thinking that we're better than other people. That somebody else should do that job because I don't do that kind of work anymore. And Jesus gave us that example of getting down on his hands and knees and getting dirty to show love. And he said, go and do likewise. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we know that you are amazing. That you love us with a love that we can't fully comprehend. And when we really try to wrap our minds around that, we realize, we understand how small we are and how lost we are without you. And then, God, we lose sight of it. We lose sight of your love. We lose sight of your power and your majesty, and we start to think about how great we are. And we get lost in our own delusions of grandeur. We get lost in our own self-importance. And God, we confess that to you this morning. We lay that at your feet. God, help us to be humble. It doesn't mean we have to be doormats, but help us to have a real, true understanding of our place in this world. That you've called us to love one another, to help one another, to wash each other's hands, wash each other's feet, to give when we're able, and to receive when we need it. God, teach us humility. In Jesus' precious name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We're going to continue our worship through our joyful giving. As the ushers come forward, this is always a reminder of the great and good gifts that God has given us. We're going to take some time to give back out of the abundance. Father, we thank you so much for all of the good gifts that you've given us. We thank you for this place that we can gather in worship. We thank you for the people that gather here and the relationships that we have built. God, as we give these tithes and offerings this morning, we pray that you would give us wisdom to know how to use these gifts to further your kingdom here and around the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. You may be seated. We are going to spend some time in prayer, and I have a couple of prayer concerns to raise. Emily is back in the hospital, and we need to pray for Emily and her family. She gave me a whole list of stuff to pray for. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but you know, praying for Emily and her spirit. It's just exhausting to be in and out of the hospital and not have answers. She wants us to pray for the doctors. She's got to have some imaging done, and some of the hardware that she has in her body sometimes makes it hard to get clear images, so we're praying for clear images. And praying for the family. It's hard for the kids to have mom in the hospital and all that. So just keep that whole family in your prayers. And I know many of you know this, but in June, I'm going to be a grandpa. So many of you here have children, right? And you know what it's like to go through that process, and it's scary, right? There's a lot going on. Not for me. I mean, at the moments it is for me, but I'm thinking about my daughter, right? So I just want to ask you to keep my daughter Leah in your prayers. You know, you do all these doctor's appointments, and sometimes they have really good news, and sometimes they say, well, we're not sure what to do about this, and you go, wait, what? You know, so just keep her in your prayers, and we're just praying for a healthy baby. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we gather in this place with humble hearts. We get carried away sometimes in our own importance, but we gather here, we gather to worship you, to acknowledge that you are the one worthy of honor and glory. We gather here because we want to acknowledge, we want to remind ourselves that you are on the throne and we are not. We spend so much time worrying about making the right decisions and doing the right thing and making all these plans and thinking through all these things. And that's not bad in and of itself, but we get caught up to the point that we don't consult you in those decisions. And we want to make those decisions in our own wisdom and in our own strength of mind. God, we gather to worship. Because you are holy. Because you are all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-loving. God, you love us in spite of ourselves, though however often we find ourselves straying from the path, finding our way deep into the woods, you continue to chase us down. And love us with a love that we can never fully understand. God, we gather here to say thank you for all of the amazing things that you do for us. The ways that we can see, we can look back over the story of our lives and we can see time and time again where you were there, where you held us up when we couldn't stand in our own strength. When you caught our tears when we were alone. When you partied with us in celebration for the amazing things that were happening in our lives. God, you've been there through it all. And God, we also come to you today with concerns and cares and people that we want to lift up to you and just beg that you would heal their bodies and their minds. God, today we lift Emily up to you. God, I pray that you would heal that wound in her body. That the imaging would be clear, the doctors would see exactly what the problem is and know exactly how to address it. And that whatever medicine or procedure they do, God, that it would be successful and that she can, that wound can just be closed and healed. That she can get back to doing the things, to caring for her family and working and all the things that she would rather be doing than sitting in a hospital. God, we lift up those children to you that you would wrap your arms around them, give them peace, help them to know love. Lord, calm their fears. It's a scary thing to have a parent in the hospital. And God, others in our family, in our community, that need your healing touch, God, we pray for it today. We lay them at your feet. We beg for healing. Lord, hear us now as we pray the way you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing together, Just As I Am. And I invite you to stand if you're able.
In a room just upstairs, God sits among his friends and would-be enemies. His disciples repose about him, on his left, on his right, their feet engrossed by the same muck and mire caked upon his. Why wouldn't they be? They've been walking the same streets, trod the same paths. They have followed their rabbi, and the dust off his heels has covered their bodies, telling of where they've been, where he has led them. The dirt tells a story of the life God incarnate firsthand instructed them, inspired them to live by living it first.
Their rabbi stands in the middle of their simple meal. In the middle of their peaceful repose, he stands. The disciples have grown to know their teacher to be abrupt, forthright, unusual even at times. And once again, they're about to witness something great, and yet something so small.
Removing his outer robes, their rabbi exchanges them for a towel. Tying it around his waist, his hands reached with designed purpose for a large bowl and a pitcher of water. With resolve, he moves back to the table where these 12 men now sit silently watching him, wondering at him. He never ceases to amaze them. Well, most of them.
Dropping to his knees, he sits at the feet of Andrew. He reaches out and without a word takes his foot up into his hands, and begins washing Andrew's feet. Andrew is frozen by his own confusion. His brow furrows, and his body tenses at the sight of his rabbi kneeling just below him, performing the work of a common servant, a slave even. His rabbi looks up at him, smiles. Andrew's tension lessens by his friend's reassuring face. Turning his head to the eyes he knows are watching him, Andrew communicates his confusion back to his fellow disciples, and with the same face they convey to him. Looking down, his feet are clean, but the rabbi is not finished.
He moves to James, and taking up the same posture, begins to wash his feet. James, too, is still and silent as his teacher, his friend, washes away the dirt and dinge crusted on his feet. All eyes are on their rabbi as he finishes and does not stop with these two.
No, he moves to Philip with the same determination, and then Bartholomew, followed by James, son of Alphaeus, washing their feet too. Still no one has spoken except one, who leaned in close to the man beside him to whisper, "What is he doing?"
Only to be met with an answer in the form of the shrugging of his shoulders.
Matthew, followed by Thaddeus, were the next to have their feet washed, followed by John, then Simon. All sat in astonishment. All sat in disbelief, for one reason or another.
Peter's hands tightened with white grip. His rabbi was just picking up the basin from Thomas's now clean feet, and Peter knew he was sitting next to Thomas. Looking down at his feet, Peter saw them for what they were. They were revolting, even to his own eyes. He knew where these feet had been. Places known to be dirty, dingy, disgusting, highly undesirable places to travel. The evidence was on his feet. His feet were a portrait of the paths that he had wandered, good and bad. Peter was roused from his silent reverie by the sudden touch of his rabbi's hands on his foot.
"No!"
Peter shouted. Startled from his seat, Peter stepped away from where the rabbi sat on the ground before him.
"No!"
he spoke again, with less brashness and more control, as he had learned these past 3 years. And he added,
"You will never wash my feet. Never. I am not worthy of you. You washing my feet? I should be washing your feet. I should be licking the dirt off your soles. No, Lord, you will never wash my feet."
The room fell into an even more silent silence. Their rabbi stood and looked his frazzled friend in the face and said to him, "What I'm doing, you do not understand now, but afterward, you will." Jesus motioned for Peter to sit back down so he could continue. But Peter was still unconvinced, still resolved to remain untouched by the Savior. Then Jesus said, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." With that, Peter fell to the ground, head bowed in submission, exclaiming,
"Then not only my feet, Lord, but my hands and my head too."
Jesus smiled as he embraced this new spirit in his friend. The one who has bathed does not need to wash, except for his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not every one of you. Jesus went back on his knees, took up the cloth, poured on the water, and wiped away the dust and the dirt, the muck and the mire from the feet of his friend.
"Not every one of you?" The ominous phrase sang in every ear. And there was one man left, one pair of dirty feet still in need of washing. At the end of the row sat one who purposely distanced himself from the head of the table. He purposefully abandoned a closer seat. But the basin, still in hand, and his feet, still in reach, Jesus did as he would do with any man in desperate need. And taking up the floor at Judas's feet, the Lord washed with equal, if not great care, those feet that were in that moment he knew itching to further stray. Those feet that in a moment would run away and betray him.
Sweat on his brow, he returned the bowl and towel, and dressing resumed his place. And he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then your Lord, your teacher, has washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you."
You have given us an example that we should do as you have done for us.
Do as you have done.
Live as you have lived.
I always debate when to put that in the service, and then I always make the mistake of putting it right before my sermon, because then I have to follow it. And I kind of just want to walk out and go, "There was your sermon." Thank you. Our story today, we know now, is the story of Jesus washing his disciples' feet. And as I said earlier, we're going to spend these next 6 weeks just kind of marinating, soaking ourselves in these last 24 hours of Jesus' life. Jesus knew that his time was short. He knew that the end was near. And he was very particular about what he did with those last 24 hours. And I think there's a lot for us to learn in these chapters. It's really interesting, you know, as we read the Gospels, we get this broad brush picture of Jesus' life, and we get these glimpses into certain things that happened, into certain stories that he told, and we know that historically Jesus' ministry lasted about 3 years. And these Gospels, you can sit down and read them in about an hour or so. So you know that you're just getting little pieces of Jesus' ministry, let alone his life. But here we have this section that goes from chapter 13 all the way through chapter 19. That covers a 24-hour period. We've got 7 chapters of granular detail of this one day in Jesus' life. And it begins here at the beginning of chapter 13. I'm going to read for you the first 20 verses of John chapter 13. And it says this: "Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, 'Lord, are you going to wash my feet?' Jesus answered, 'You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand.' Peter said to him, 'You will never wash my feet.' And Jesus answered, 'Unless I wash you, you have no share with me.' And Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head. And Jesus said to him, the one who has washed, who has bathed, does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you. For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, not all of you are clean. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. I'm not speaking of all of you. I know whom I have chosen, but it is to fulfill the scripture. The one who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. I tell you this now before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe that I am he. Very truly, I tell you, whoever receives one whom I send receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. What a powerful story. I thought about sitting up here and having you guys come forward so I could wash your feet while I gave my sermon, and I knew that none of you would come. So I figured another plan. Because we're all kind of like Peter, right? You're not going to touch my feet. My feet are gross. And it's like so many of these stories, it's kind of hard for us to wrap our minds around it because foot washing is just, it's just something we don't do, right? We don't wash each other's feet. You know, I'm guessing the only time any of us have washed another person's foot was when we had babies, right? And there's maybe some weird situations where somebody hurts themselves, you need to wash their foot, but it just doesn't happen. But back in that culture, it was an everyday occurrence. There were no paved roads. They were walking around in the dirt. They wore sandals, so their feet were dusty and dirty all the time. And like Jesus said to Peter, they washed, they bathed, they were clean. But when you're walking around in sandals on dirt roads, your feet get dirty. And if you were a person of any kind of means, you had servants, and those servants would be waiting at the door to wash the feet of any guest that came into your house. And it wasn't the top servant that was washing people's feet, right? It was the guy at the bottom of the totem pole. I can imagine, you know, in the backyard before everybody shows up, they're playing rock, paper, scissors to find out who's got to wash feet today. Or they got a new guy and they go, well, you're the new guy. You get to go wash feet today. It wasn't a glamorous thing. And Jesus is being very specific in what he's teaching his disciples. Now, the interesting thing, he does say to them, because I have washed your feet, I want you to go wash other people's feet or wash each other's feet. So the question is, why is foot washing not a regular ritual in the Christian church? Right? Why don't we wash feet? And my argument to that is that because it really wasn't about washing feet. Right? Foot washing was very unique to that culture. Right? The best equivalent that I could come up with in my head was if I was to get a big old jug of hand sanitizer and start walking around the room and sanitizing everybody's hands. Right? That's something that we all know, we all understand. You walk into a building and right in the entryway there's a thing of hand sanitizer for you to sanitize your hands. You walk into the hospital, there's hand sanitizers. You walk into the college, there's hand sanitizer. We do that every day, right? But it wasn't about the physical washing of the feet, but he's saying, I want you to serve each other. I want you to be willing to get dirty, to be willing to get on your hands and your knees and serve one another. Humiliate yourself for the people you love. Be willing. Jesus, it says that he took off his robe. He took his clothes off and wrapped a towel around his waist. Here's Jesus with nothing but a towel wrapped around his waist, on his hands and knees, in front of his students. How many teachers do we have here? I know there's a few of you, right? How many of you would wrap a towel around yourself and get on your hands and knees in front of your students? Not likely. That's what he's calling us to do, to serve one another, to be willing to serve each other at the most base, dirty, humiliating level. Can we serve each other like that? I mentioned last week that I feel this sense as I've been putting together these messages that God is kind of drilling into us this message that we are called to be different. If we are going to follow Jesus, we cannot look like the rest of society. If we look like everybody else, if we act like everybody else, if we do things the way everybody else does things, then we're not following Jesus well. Then we haven't quite figured it out yet, because he calls us to be different, to live lives that goes against the grain of society. This is exactly what he's teaching in this moment. He says, no other rabbi, no other teacher would do this. It just doesn't make sense. But I'm doing it in the last 24 hours of my life. Have you ever thought about that, what you would do if you knew that you had 24 hours to live? Just think about that for a moment. Think of what you would want to do with that time. We'd probably want to be with the people closest to us. We'd probably want to either spend time just kind of huddled up with our people or out doing something fun so we could have some fun memory together. And Jesus wrapped a towel around his waist, and he served those that he cared about. It says, right at the beginning, he says, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And then it goes on to show how he loved us. And we have this image of Peter, and I love Peter. Peter, if I'm allowed to say it, Peter's my favorite disciple. I know we're not supposed to have favorite kids, but we can have favorite disciples. And Peter is my favorite disciple, probably because I'm the most like Peter, because Peter always talked before he thought. Right? Something would happen, and Peter would just blurt out whatever was in his brain. Or he'd pull his sword out and cut off somebody's ear. And Jesus had to pull him back and go, no, that's not how we're going to do this. That's not how this works. Slow down. Right? There was even a time where Peter blurted something out and Jesus said to him, said, get behind me, Satan. Ouch. If Jesus says, get behind me, Satan, you're in trouble. That's when I've just heard, Randall Scott Bennett. That's big trouble. But Peter, in all of his brashness and all of his, I always talk about there's a trap door between the brain and the mouth. And some people, that trap door just kind of hangs loosely, right? And Peter was one of those guys. The trap door just didn't work. And he just blurts it out. And he says, No. You're not going to wash my feet. Let me trade places with you for a minute, and I'll wash your feet. And in doing so, what is he saying? I'm going to show that I'm even better than the rest of these guys because they let you wash their feet. But I'm going to show that I know what's going on, and I'm going to get on my hands and knees, and I'm going to wash your feet, and they're going to see that I get it. And Jesus says, shh, sit down. Let me wash your feet. If I don't wash your feet, then you have no part of me. And again, the trapdoor fails. And Peter says, well, then wash all of me. Wash my hands and my head and just wash all of me then, because I want all of you. And again, Jesus, just shh. The only part of you that's dirty right now is your feet. Let me wash your feet. And he does this for all of his disciples. All of his disciples, including Judas. And we know, it tells us right at the beginning in verse 3, it says, going back to verse 2. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. So Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him. You're spending some time with your best friends, and you know that one of them is going to stab you in the back later that night. Are you going to give them the same treatment that you give your other friends? That's a tough one, isn't it? But we know this. Jesus washed Judas' feet. And later, they leave from here and they go to the upper room and they eat the Passover meal together. And Jesus breaks bread and he gives it to Judas. And you say, yeah, Randy, but that's Jesus. I mean, it's Jesus. Come on. I mean, of course, Jesus is going to do that, but I can't do that. I'm not Jesus. I'm not Jesus either. That's what he calls us to do. He says, go and do likewise. He knows that we're not perfect. He knows we're not going to get it right every time, but he's saying, go and love the way that I have loved you. Serve people the way that I have served you. Be willing to humiliate yourself the way I've humiliated myself. Go and do likewise. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. And we can see how you lived your life. And that in these last 24 hours, you knew your time was limited, so you had to be really blunt. You didn't have time for the story to sink in or for the lesson to catch. So you just came out and said it. You said, look, guys, I'm doing this to set you an example. And God, it's written down so we have that example. You say, live like this. Love like this. And God, give us the courage to live that way and to love that way. You are amazing, and you love us more than we could ever deserve, and for that we thank you. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. We're going to conclude today by singing His Name is Wonderful. If you want to follow along in the hymnal, it's hymn number 230. I invite you to stand if you're able.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord.
And I need your help, Mindy, because I didn't write anything down, so I'm just going off the screen here. A few announcements as we go. Lent Bible study starts this week. We're going to take that book, The Art of Neighboring, that I used as kind of a launching pad for the last 6 weeks, and we're going to dig really deep into that. If you'd like to sign up, there's still time. We've got a couple extra books. It's $5 for a book. If you can't afford a book, we'll give you one. And we'll be here Wednesday nights, 6 o'clock. We're going to have a potluck and Bible study. Choir next week. Choir next week. If you want to sing in the choir, be here at 9 o'clock. Sunday morning, and you can sing with the choir. We've got a couple of meetings this week. We have a trustee meeting today following worship. Our women's prayer group meets Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock. As you leave this place, go with this example that Jesus set for us, to serve and love the way Jesus loved and served. Go in peace. Amen.